السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أعزائي طلاب المرحلة الرابعة, this is the fourth lecture in the pharmacotherapy series and it is the last one. Just I wanted to repeat the antibodies because maybe I explained this at the final of the past lecture and I want just to confirm the information in this category. So antibodies, it is now a very active or hot area for the development of new drugs as anti-cancer drugs because these agents are hugely or tremendously different from other chemotherapies since they are very specific agents to certain targets and receptors in the bodies. And also they are very different from other chemotherapies in the side effect profiles. So these are, this gives a high potential for these agents to be combined with other chemotherapies for cancer treatments and can be administered either by intravenous administration or by infusion. Just I wanted from you just three drugs from this table: bevacizumab, cetuximab, and trastuzumab. The first one targets or blocks the VEGF or targets VEGF and prevent VEGF vascular endothelial growth factor from binding to its receptor, and this leads to less blood, new blood vessel formations. And as we know, tumors need a lot of blood and nutrients to grow and become larger, so this prevents the enough blood and the nutrients to reach to the tumors and cause tumor inhibition. The major side effects related to this drug: hypertension, gastrointestinal perforation, proteinuria, some problems in wound healing, and bleeding. Then cetuximab, this one targets another receptors, targets endothelial growth factor, epidermal growth factor receptor. So binds to these receptors and prevents epidermal growth factors from binding to these receptors and cause inhibition in the tumor growth. And also this causes activation of apoptosis, and apoptosis, as we said, induce cell death in cancer cells. This drug could induce skin rash, electrolyte wasting, infusion reaction, and diarrhea as side effects. While the last one, trastuzumab, this one also targeting epidermal growth factor. It is called the human epidermal growth factors receptors type 2. And this one causes also inhibition for tumor growth due to blocking this receptor. This drug, the last one, could induce cardiomyopathy, infusion-related fever and chills, pulmonary toxicity, and nausea, vomiting. So these are the most important three agents that I wanted you to know from this class. Then we have tyrosine kinase inhibitors. And tyrosine enzymes or tyrosine kinase, very important enzymes or family of enzymes that are involving in many or different processes inside the cells in order to induce signal transduction and cell division. So they are mainly involved in the cell growth, cell divisions, regulating intracellular signals. These are very important enzymes, and we have a very large number of tyrosine kinases, around 50 of these kinases inside the cells, responsible for cell growth, cell division, through phosphorylation of signaling proteins. Accordingly, these enzymes or these kinases are targeted due to their involvement on cell growth. So prevent cell growth through targeting kinases enzymes. The tyrosine kinase inhibitors can be used orally, and this is a good advantage for these agents, and can be used for different kinds of tumors. What I wanted to know from this group is imatinib. And imatinib targets tyrosine kinase, it called BCR-ABL kinase. BCR-ABL kinase. This is an important enzyme responsible for cell growth. This drug imatinib could induce myelosuppression, fluid retention, and congestive heart failure as side effects. This is what it is required from this table. Then we have immunotherapy. And immunotherapy, we talked just briefly in the beginning about a new direction in treatment of cancers through targeting the immune response, targeting the checkpoints and the immune response. And these checkpoints are important to maintain the immune response in certain levels, not too low response, not too high response. So accordingly, inhibitors have been developed to these checkpoints in order to overactivate the immune response and attack tumors. So we can see with the goal of the immune checkpoint inhibitors, blocking the checkpoint molecules. And a very famous example of these inhibitors is what it is called programmed death receptors. And we have here two inhibitors, pembrolizumab and nivolumab. Both of them are targeting this molecule, and this molecule an important checkpoint molecule in the immune response. After inhibition, this checkpoint, there is an overactivation for the immune system, and the immune system starts to destruct a tumor in certain organs. The adverse reaction, however, the adverse reaction, adverse reactions that are related to these two drugs or to, in general, targeting these checkpoints is overactivated immune response, and sometimes it is a fatal immune-mediated adverse events. This is because the turning off the immune checkpoints and allows attacks of the tumors, but can also lead to unchecked autoimmune response, which attacks the other organs or parts inside the bodies, even they are normal, even there is no tumor in these organs, but this is overstimulated immune response and could cause destruction to many other parts inside the body. So that we will see a huge number of the adverse effects, such as diarrhea, colitis, pneumonitis, etc., and all of them very serious side effects. And as we said, it could be a fatal immune-mediated adverse effects. Patients should be closely monitoring if they are taking these drugs for the due to the potential of developing serious side effects that are related to the overactivated immune immunity. And also it is necessary to use drugs that are that have anti-allergic effects, such as corticosteroids, diphenhydramines, etc. Then we have miscellaneous agents, and here we have two categories, abiraterone acetate and immunomodulating agents. With the abiraterone, this agent is now used to treat metastatic castrations resistance prostate cancer, this kind of prostate cancer resistance even for the castration, and is not used alone, is used in a combination with the prednisone or prednisolone. This is the same drug. And this one, abiraterone, inhibits CYP17, and this is an important enzyme required for androgen synthesis. So this is like inhibits androgen synthesis through inhibition CYP17. But prednisone or prednisolone is used in combination with this drug because inhibition, this enzyme is not only reduced the testosterone level, but also it causes an increase in the level of melanocorticoids. And to maintain the level between mineralocorticoids and corticosteroids, it is important to use a prednisone in combination with with the abiraterone because the inhibition of CYP17. So the major rationale for using prednisone with the abiraterone just to maintain the balance of the equilibrium between mineralocorticoids with the corticosteroids due to the inhibition of CYP17. Hepatotoxicity may occur with those patients in addition to other side effects such as hypertension, hypokalemia, and fluid retention, and these are related to the increase in the level of mineralocorticoids. Joint and muscle discomfort, hot flashes, diarrhea, also other side effects that could happen with this drug or with these two drugs in combination. Then we have immunomodulating agents, and here we have thalidomide, lenalidomide, and pomalidomide. These agents is not fully understood why they have anti-tumor effects. Even they are now used to treat multiple myeloma, but their exact mechanism of action is not fully understood. It is believed that these agents could have anti-angiogenic, less blood vessel formation, immune modulation, overactivation for certain pathways in the immune system, which are targeting the tumor cells, maybe anti-inflammatory and anti-proliferative effects. These agents now, as we said, in for multiple myeloma, but could be used in combination with other agents such as dexamethasone. Adverse effect, thromboembolism, myelosuppression, fatigue, these are some of them serious side effects. It is known in the history of pharmacology that thalidomide was given maybe in the 60s of the previous century to treat motion sickness, morning sickness in pregnant women, but it led to very serious side effects or severe birth defects for chlamydia and these side effects, and this prevented the use of this drug anymore for pregnant women. And this could not be only for thalidomide, but also for other agents. So there is a special precaution or contraindication for using this drug during pregnancy. Now, finally, we have proteasome inhibitors. And here we have three drugs, bortezomib, ixazomib, and carfilzomib. These agents are inhibitors, are proteasome inhibitors. And what proteasome does, it is like an apparatus or organelles responsible for destruction of proteins that are inducing apoptosis. So by preventing destruction of these ones, of proteasomes, we are inducing apoptosis in cells, and this is a very recommended effect in cancer cells to induce cell death in these agents. So all of these agents now used to treat multiple myeloma, and as we said in the mechanism, prevent the degradation of pro-apoptotic factors leading to promotion of programmed cell death, apoptosis in malignant cells. Bortezomib, this one can be given by intravenous administration, but subcutaneous route of administration is now more preferred since it is associated with less neuropathy. Other adverse effect that is related to this drug is myelosuppression, diarrhea, fatigue, herpes zoster reactivation, and this causes a need for using antiviral drug while using this drug. While ixazomib, this one can be given orally, and it has a similar side effect profile to the bortezomib. Carfilzomib, and this one can be given by intravenous administration, and is a kind like similar to the side effect profile to the other agents. So mainly they are different in the routes of administration. Then finally, we have, this is a very important figure, just to summarize, it is called Chemoman figure. This one summarizes the most common toxicities with the chemotherapies. So we can see here from these letters and different parts in this cartoon here, right here, like C or B's or T or O. This one, each one of them resembles or signed for different drug with different toxicities. So let's take here with cisplatin. Cisplatin here, like in this purple color, could cause ototoxicity, nephrotoxicity, in addition, nausea, vomiting. Let's take here the, let's say, bleomycin or busulfan. Both of them induce pulmonary toxicity, and these here, we can find them right here. Let's say take with the vincristine and oxaliplatin. Both of them are with the taxanes, these agents, but all of them could induce peripheral neuropathy. So we can see them here, right here, or here, right here, right here. So it is important, very important figure to summarize the side effect that we saw with all these agents. This lecture until this point, we done with the chemotherapies. And this lecture is a kind of a short lecture just to finish the chemotherapies. Of course, please let me know if you have any questions or concerns about any part in the chemotherapies, and I will be happy to answer your questions. Thank you very much.